I think it's when you have a president that has sabotaged
being greeted by a man named Federico Pinciato Jr., who will be a large part of this presentation. So those who are familiar with Brazil are aware that Medici was president during Brazil's military dictatorship. And among the authoritarian politics and nature of that dictatorship, also race was also a feature of that, particularly this doubling down on the idea of racial democracy. So it may appear very interesting that the representative of the military dictatorship is meeting a man who is representative of a Black organization. But I want to highlight a part of the speech that Pinciato Jr. Made after Medici, after he received Medici at this event. Quote, "Today, in a time of expanded opportunities, Black Brazilians are participating in the construction of the great Brazilian nation that is a symbol of racial democracy and liberty and equality to the world. We are integrated in Brazil's destiny now, that our children can attend college, our athletes are celebrated throughout the nation and the globe, our opportunities have amplified. We want to say to the President of the Republic that we march with the Brazil of the revolution, and that in this square, we are together in front of the humanitarian monument of Mãe Preta, the mother of Blacks and whites. You, i.e. Medici, have consolidated abolition in the hearts of all Brazilians." Pinciato Jr.'s speech is unsettling in its praise of Medici and firm support of the military regime. At first glance, it may seem surprising, considering how closely he linked Black Brazilians as beneficiaries of the military coup. In the early 70s, conscious raising groups and underground newspapers emerged where Black youths explicitly critiqued worsening conditions under the dictatorship. Activists such as Hamilton Cardoso, Neuza Maria Pereira, and Eduardo de Oliveira characterized the era of military rule as eerily similar to the logics of slavery. But here, Pinciato Jr. is giving the speech on May 13th, the anniversary of abolition. So in the words of Pinciato Jr., "The military coup of 1964 paved the way for Black people to be integrated in Brazil's destiny." But we have to contextualize his words and his efforts with a long view, and in particular, within a certain integrationist politics. Pinciato's group or organization, Clube dos Santos Vinci, established in 1951, sought social and cultural integration of Black people by engaging whites in their prejudices, particularly their understanding of ideal race relations. By the 1950s, most whites avoided, even if it was contrary to what they believed, articulating eugenic notions of Black inferiority in favor of cultural deficiency arguments. Clube dos Santos Vinci events and Pinciato worked to prove that Black Paulistanos, people from São Paulo, have the cultural values and ability to enjoy a racially defined consumerist society. Pinciato's politics did not champion Black electoral candidates or anti-racist mobilization against discrimination cases. Electoral politics in São Paulo were not viable enough to penetrate São Paulo's white landed power structure. Ethnic Europeans and Asians, as well as other Brazilians overall, did not vote for Black candidates in the context of redemocratization after 1945. Literacy requirements were another impediment to building power at the ballot box. Unlike the Teatro Experimental do Negro of Dias Nascimento's group in Rio de Janeiro that also had chapters in São Paulo, the Associação Cultural do Negro, among others, Clube dos Santos Vinci did not mobilize against racist hotels or restaurants. Theirs was an integrationist politics that wedded Black social mobility and white notions of race relations together to create an assimilationist nationalist project. The organization's symbolic gestures constructed or participated in idyllic narratives of the slave past in order to placate white elites enough for social concessions. In challenging anti-Black stereotypes around moral character by creating images of Black people as conspicuous consumers, Panciato's strategy hoped to open a pathway to incorporating Black people into seats of power. In order for white people to be receptive to such a strategy, Black people needed to become synonymous with to the nation itself. So here's like a photograph of one of the organization's parties that they hosted. And this, I'm going to read this excerpt from this party as well. "We want to help the Black man live and teach him to adapt to the order of things. Look at how many white men are here. Does that not prove that racial or color prejudice doesn't exist in Brazil? If there's any kind of racism, it's the Blacks that are increasing it. And it is this that we want to stop. We have a national program to integrate the Blacks of our land into the present society." The Boniquinha do Café pageant was the principal vehicle for this project. The pageant sought out young Black women and girls as contestants, with neighborhoods in the capital and cities in the interior and wider southeastern region nominating their candidates for the chance to be crowned a Black queen. The contestants represented a variety of backgrounds across the population. Many contestants were domestic workers, cooks, seamstresses, while others were teachers and nurses. The women competed across categories that emphasized glamour, patriotism, and knowledge of Black history. Contestants promoted the contest weeks before the event, visiting with members of São Paulo state representatives or congressmen, the city press corps, as well as soccer teams. In the presence of state officials like the governor, the public guard met the contestants, as you can see here, with military salutes and marches. Upon winning the competition, Clube dos Santos Vinci awarded the Boniquinha do Café on May 13th, Abolition Day, in front of the Mai Preta statue in Largo do Paissandu. The winner earned a trophy and a vacation trip to Bahia, or a city outside of Brazil. She was also tasked to represent Clube dos Santos Vinci for the entire year, visiting politicians, fundraising to expand for future Abolition Day celebrations, and recognizing Mai Preta on September 28th, the anniversary of the Free Womb Law of 1871. So this competition emphasized themes consistent with the politics of integration. Contestants were expected to perform an identity linked explicitly with the nation. Judges graded them on their ability to recite the national anthem and respond to questions of national historic importance. These efforts were typical of many beauty pageants in the Americas. My apologies, this is out of order. There we go. Not just Brazil. However, Black beauty pageants in Brazil task themselves to represent the best of the race to demonstrate their worthiness as Brazilians. The rituals of performing patriotism were rooted in a belief that they could justify Black integration at all levels of Brazilian society. In so doing, the Black beauty pageants deployed particular tropes to reach their non-Black target audience. Like their predecessors, Kluge, Doucet, Vinci stressed an idealized history of slavery but proposed abolition as proof of a white-black's shared history of intimacy and brotherhood. The trophy was named for Princesa Isabel, the imperial regent who abolished slavery by law in 1888. The trophy itself depicted an enslaved woman cultivating coffee. So Kluge, Doucet, Vinci characterized abolition of slavery as an act of integration with which Black people needed to express gratitude in order to show their goodwill. While not explicit, this expression of gratitude implied a historical debt owed to Black Brazilians. Black activists in the 1920s argued the debt could be paid by eliminating race prejudice and exclusion as historical from common narratives of Brazil's past. Kluge, Doucet, Vinci wanted integration. Yet Kluge, Doucet, Vinci's focus on slavery was part of a larger emphasis of some residents of São Paulo to make the mythology of São Paulo, the state and city, more inclusive. In the early 1950s, the national press began characterizing São Paulo as ground zero for anti-Black racism. In the aftermath of the Catherine Dunham and Miriam Anderson scandals, where hotels denied both North American women lodging on account of their race and skin color, in addition to the dozens of cases of Black Paulistas experiencing the same thing, Brazilian journalists sought to distance themselves from evidence that their country was more hostile to Black people than it advertised. Singling out São Paulo, the nation's economic powerhouse, and among the more European states, permitted journalists to render anti-Black racism a foreign problem unknown to a mixed society. By the late 50s, publishers and journalists in São Paulo increasingly emphasized coffee, the state's early source of wealth, first cultivated by enslaved labor, and its references to the state and capital. By making coffee a central component to São Paulo's regional identity, the state could fit better into Brazil's larger narrative of racial democracy through the emphasis of the state's colonial history. The rise of Black beauty pageants, especially the Boniquinha do Café, likely allowed white Paulistanos and white Brazilians to celebrate Black women as integral parts of Brazil's racial democracy, while diminishing attention to the functionally segregated nature of Brazilian beauty pageants and debutante balls overall. The contestants and their work in the pageant provide insights into the role Black women played in the politics of integration. Black women served an integral role as pageant contestants, as foot soldiers of the race. They needed to make the case to the public that Black people were contemporary, poised, and prepared enough to be visible among all levels of society. Their bodies, like the Mai Preta, were both physical and metaphorical currency that Penteado and the Black male leaders before him used to cash in for more access and influence in São Paulo's wealthier class. The Black women were limited to depictions of their capacity to serve and give. And their image was so tied to racial democracy and its mythologies that all Black women, ironically, did not equally benefit from the corporal exchange. The pageant's press coverage, paired with its financial support and legitimacy from the government, did not expand visibility of its contestants. So in the sake of time, I'm going to go between images. So this is the photo of the Mai Preta statue that was erected in São Paulo. And this is also the imagery of some of the contestants. This is a woman from the organization Renascença Clube in Rio de Janeiro, but she idealizes the mulata aesthetic. So if we look at the contestants who are presenting in front of politicians such as Governor Carvalho Pinto here, the women are typically light-skinned. However, they are trying to model a aesthetic of the Mai Preta. The Mai Preta being the wet nurse, the enslaved wet nurse who gives and sacrifices so much to the nation being idealized within a white child, typically the enslaver's child. So mixing these aesthetics together. So here is a picture of a woman, a contestant reciting the a poem that commemorates slavery. And we see more contestants here later in the mid 1960s, meeting with Governor Ademar de Barros. And we also have, while we have the contestants here, side by side, we also have the imagery that is consistent of Penchiado Jr.'s mother, Maria Penchiado, who figures prominently among in the pageant ceremonies. So she, as an older Black woman and a darker skinned Black woman at that, she gets to embody the Mai Preta and its symbolism. In 1963, then President Joao Goulart came to accept an award on behalf of the Republic from Clube dos Santos Vinci. And on the plaque, it said, "The descendants for whom whose blood fed and gave life to coffee, which sustained Brazil's wealth and progress, would like to offer to the President of the Republic their gratitude in the presence of the efforts towards the highest promotion of the Brazilian Black family." But to close, strategy actually work? And we do have a clue from press that highlighted Clube dos Santos Vinci outside of these pageants. So this is a profile from the magazine Cigarra, which is analogous to Life magazine. And they had a spread on the club preparing for a Abolition Day party. And this is among the imagery that they showcased, and along with some descriptions of the people who went there. Quote, "Some young men ostentatiously wore large gold rings, giant cufflinks, white handkerchiefs in their jacket pockets, half on the outside and a pendant on the lapel. Others dressed more discreetly, and many of the young women would make the ladies of the white world jealous." And although there were white people in attendance, the profile's pictures did not really include them. So the magazine's uses of and phrases of language indicated an additional layer. Though Black people were enjoying whiskey and dressing well and earning enough money, that seemed to be contrary to the majority of depictions or the popular depictions of Black people in Brazilian society. While there are no Mai Pretas or mulatas there, the magazine did try to box Clube dos Santos within that imagery. So to close, Penchiado Jr. and Clube dos Santos Boniquinha do Café objective was to reorient Brazilians away from anti-Black prejudices towards acceptance of Black beauty while reifying white femininity, proximity to whiteness, and internalized anti-Blackness. The strategy argued Black people needed to be incorporated into the political and social life of São Paulo's upper classes. Integration required Black people to fashion themselves in the ways legible to white people through debutante balls and pageants, expensive clothing, and invoking slavery tropes and myths. Integrationist thinking required Black people to meet white people at their stereotypes, biases, and prejudices against Black people. They did this to obtain the currency to purchase access to upper class social spaces. Clube do Santos Vinci sold to governors and presidents repurposed paternalistic narratives of slavery that recast slavery as the genesis for São Paulo's wealth. Black women and girls performed Mai Preta and the Mulata to translate their bodies to white audiences. Politicians in the upper classes rewarded Clube do Santos with visibility and occasional cultural legitimacy, but Black people did not reap any rewards in education, housing, or labor. They did not really join the planter class and their progeny. They smelled power at the table, but could not sit down and taste it. They were still out of place and not in power. Thank you.
Thank you, Cassie. Now we're gonna have Kat Cosby give her a presentation.
Give me just a brief moment. I am having camera issues for whatever reason. There we go. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yep.
Great. So what I'm going to present is part of my second chapter of my dissertation, which is largely on Black women's geographies in the city of São Paulo and the afterlife of slavery from 1870 to 1930. And this is just kind of a snippet of what I've been able to do throughout my dissertation. In this paper, I aim to demonstrate not only why it is necessary to reconsider our thinking about the afterlife of slavery in Brazil, but also why we must foreground the lives and experiences of Black women in the years after abolition. The abolition of slavery occurred gradually through a series of laws related to ethnic relations and gave way for the social meaning and the material conditions in the afterlife of slavery. Even after abolition, slavery was not archaic or incompatible with late 19th and early 20th century realities, as many Black people continued to labor in the same positions as they did during slavery, and Blackness remained to be linked to labor and station in life, not solely phenotype. Thus, it is unsurprising that many Black Brazilians continued to work on plantations or became janitors, bodyguards, domestic servants, and washerwomen after abolition. Though academic historiography on this period in Brazil has insisted on the notion of radical cleavages being inaugurated by the doctrine of political emancipation, the study of Black women's lives in Brazil indicate that emancipation was not the rupture that we often imagine it to be. While other Brazilian scholars, including Kim Butler and Barbara Weinstein, have written about how race and labor operate in the early 20th century, my concerns about historiography and geography engage with the scholarship on the long 19th century. My work is concerned with how labor, race, and gender shaped the ways that Black women were meant to navigate their lives and the possibilities they created within the limits placed on them due to their race and gender. By examining an interview from the memory of slavery in Black families in São Paulo, I argue that labor, gender, and geography should be interrogated together to understand how Black women survived the long 19th century and maintained familial ties in the city of São Paulo. In the late 19th and early 20th century, São Paulo urban landscapes reproduced slavocratic spatial logic practices of domination by the elite and state actors through racial sexual hierarchies and difference that created a common sense as to which bodies belonged in particular spaces. Lugares de gente negra, or places for Black people, were located in popular neighborhoods, and the white elite were meant to occupy noble neighborhoods. The most common distinctions of the long 19th century Paulistano geographic spaces were noble neighborhoods and popular neighborhoods that superficially denote class markers as to who belonged to each respective neighborhood. However, reading the São Paulo geographic landscape of noble neighborhoods and popular neighborhoods through racial capitalism, and certainly through an understanding of the synthesis of class as a marker of the process of racialization of the long 19th century, and Catherine McKittrick's formulation of geography exposes practices of domination and the type of racial sexual bodies that belonged in these spaces. Black Paulistana women were more than their social and economic conditions in the late 19th and early 20th century. Interviews taken by university researchers and their students in 1988, entitled Memoria de Escravidão en Familias Negras en São Paulo, or The Memory of Slavery in Black Families in São Paulo, marked the centennial of the end of slavery and the legacies of slavery for Black families in São Paulo. The collection comprises of 114 depositions from 45 families in the state of São Paulo. And here I read the Memory of Slavery in Black Families in São Paulo interviews as similar to WPA testimony in the United States and Eusebia Hartman's cautions of relations of power in the WPA testimonies between the interviewee and interviewer and my readings of these interviews. The collection features interviewees who varied in generations removed from slavery. So some were first, second, and third, fourth in some cases. Some of the interviewers' notes taken after each set of interviews demonstrate that they did not capture the memories they sought for their project. Yet the interviews in the Memory of Slavery and Black Families in São Paulo contain a host of Black histories in São Paulo with memories spanning from slavery into the 20th century. The memories from the first generation Black women in these interviews underlie the conditions and continuities of slavery from the late 19th century until the 20th century. The interviews gave space for Black interviewees to tell their stories of their families using references that were significant to them. Benedita, an elder Black participant in the interviews, began to work as a domestic servant when she was 10 years old in 1920 in the city of Casablanca in São Paulo. And here on the map, you can see Casablanca is where the pen is dropped in the circle, and São Paulo is more toward the south. Casablanca is located in the interior close to the state of Minas Gerais. At 15, she moved to São Paulo and worked and lived with a family at Marechal Deodoro Square on Albuquerque Lynn Street and Santa Cecilia, while her mother worked as a live-in maid for another family in Bexiga. Benedita did not see her mother often and did not know how to transit through the city to see her mother without someone else's assistance. Often she was not able to see her mother for months. She eventually asked another domestic worker in the home in Albuquerque Lynn to take her to see her mother. As Benedita tells it, I would ask the maid, take me to see my mother. I would ask the cook. The cook would say, imagine if I were to miss one of my dances to take you to see your mother. Go on your own. So I cried. One day I spoke to my patroa, which is a word that I've had trouble translating because it kind of means mistress as well as boss. So again, one of those moments where you see the continuities of slavery coming into the 20th century. Benedita said, I'm going to learn to get around São Paulo. I'm going to go a month without seeing my mother because I don't know how to navigate São Paulo. I'm going to start to go out. She said to me, Giti, she called me Gicinha. Beneditona was the cook, and I was Beneditina, the page. When I went to tell her, I said, Dona Flora, I'm going to see my mother today. She said, Beneditina, you will not go. You will get lost here in São Paulo. I said, no, I'm going. I will not get lost. And I left. Benedita began her interview by interlacing her life trajectory with memories of her mother and work in the interior of São Paulo in the early 20th century. When she and her mother moved to the capital, they labored and lived in separate households, and her younger sister lived with her mother. Social and economic structures conditioned how Benedita and her mother spent time together and the ways that Benedita's mother mothered. Benedita narrates a story about transiting the city to see her mother with a fair amount of detail for an event that occurred approximately 6 decades before the interview took place. Benedita's story conveyed her desire and insistence on maintaining a relationship with her mother despite their conditions. In Benedita's narrative of her reunion with her mother, she provides specific details about the spatial memory of her trajectory. And here we have a map that I'll zoom in on later, but the circle is where I'm going to be zooming in on. Benedita went to Albuquerque Lins to take a train to the neighborhood of Bixiga by descending down Albuquerque Lins Street to Praça do Correio. According to Benedita, the train went up to the Viaducto do Chá and went down to Libero Badaró. She took the train to Praça do Correio and transferred to train number 5, Paraíso, to Major Diogo Street. She asked the conductor to let her know when they had reached the street, as she was afraid she would get lost. When she reached her mother's residence, she rang the doorbell and she saw her mother's patroa. The woman asked, "Who did you come with?" I said, "I came by myself." She said, Paulina, your daughter is here." My mother said, "Who?" "My daughter, Dita." She said, "Yes, she is." My mother said, "That's not possible." When my mother came and saw me, she said, "My daughter, you came." "I came by myself, mother, I came." The geographic references in her story were integral and significant to spending time with her mother. The names of the streets and trains used by Paulistanos for a variety of activities every day were connected to the geography that Benedita created for herself and her mother. And here I have like an approximate route. It's not perfect, but it's kind of a, you can see how far she's gone. And one of the features of São Paulo that you can't really see on this map is that it's really hilly, and it made it a little bit more difficult to navigate. So it's not just a straight shot and way to go. Locating and mapping Black women in traditional geographies helps to clarify negotiated territories of exploitation, exploration, and conquest, but traditional geographies are limited in the kinds of narratives they can produce. Historical narratives within the scope of traditional geographies often tend to naturalize identity, place, and space of difference. Catherine McKittrick's framework of geography in a move away from traditional geographies insists that, quote, social practices create landscapes and contribute to how we organize, build, and imagine our surroundings. McKittrick's emphasis on social practices enable and compel us to consider the meanings, imaginaries, and social practices around how spaces are assembled and organized. The logic of racial capitalism and patriarchal order has defined and shaped visions of traditional geography that simultaneously reassert its legitimacy as an organizing system. Traditional geography, according to McKittrick, quote, points to formulations that assume we can view, assess, and ethically organize the world from a stable, meaning white, patriarchal, Eurocentric, heterosexual, classed vantage point, unquote. While these formulations, cartographic, positivist, imperialist, have been retained and resisted within and beyond the discipline of human geography, they also clarify that Black women are negotiating a geographic landscape that is upheld by a legacy of exploitation, exploration, and conquest. Black Paulistano women and Black Paulistanos have often been placed in cartographies of traditional geographies that demonstrate displacement of Black people during the fast-paced urbanization and transformations of São Paulo in the early 20th century. Thus, Benedita's flight from her workplace and residence through the busy city by train is a feat noteworthy of historical record and analysis. Benedita's job as a domestic servant to some degree provides a pass for her presence in Santa Cecilia. The neighborhood of Santa Cecilia where Benedita resided maintained some of the characteristics of the Chácara Palmeiras. If you are familiar with football at all, you might have heard Palmeiras from the football team, comes from the same name, and the constructed mansions, which were characteristic of these noble neighborhoods. A chácara is a large urban property that was typically a secondary property of a family used for recreation and leisure on the weekends. Traditional geographies presume some transparency as to what and who was held in a place, and that space just is, masking the social dynamics and the creation of noble neighborhoods in distinction with popular neighborhoods. By maintaining characteristics of chácaras and building mansions, a practice that is most frequently linked to the nostalgia of Northeasterners and identity vis-a-vis the South, the elite and state actors preserve material elements of the slavocratic plantation. So the map here is a topographical map from 1930. So this is basically when we think about modern São Paulo, is more or less what it looks like today. There's a square kind of on the right side of the map. We just zoom in and take a look at that. You can see like a planta, meaning the, I guess, the plan for the space. And there's a circle here in white. You can see Chácara Bertioga, as well as Chácara Paraíso, so that these chácaras were still existing well into the 20th century. Benedita's job as a domestic servant in the early 20th century placed her in a set of conditions and geographies that were not dissimilar to the type of labor and spatial configurations during slavery. As historians of the 19th century throughout the Americas have demonstrated, slaveholders expressed their power through spatial control and regulation of terrain. In the context of São Paulo, historians Maria Cristina Cortez Weisenbach and Maria Ogila Silva Diaz have demonstrated that their presence and movement, the presence and movements of Black women in São Paulo were disciplined and regulated by the police and slaveholders through jail and fines. Projects of spatial control and regulation of terrain forged during slavery remained and expanded in the afterlife of slavery. Scholars on Black women in the African diaspora have also shown the surveillance, the increased surveillance by state actors throughout the 19th century in attempts to control who had the right to occupy space. Former slaveholders, the elite, and state actors continued their territorial control over popular classes by maintaining and recreating social divisions through neighborhoods. Given the efforts put forth to maintain order and ensure progress of São Paulo to achieve a modern Europeanized future, and in a move away from the race and culture of Black enslaved past, the fact that Benedita had to learn on her own how to navigate the city is unsurprising. As a Black woman, Benedita remained outside of the possibilities of what scholar Vibeke Ibsen has called delicate citizenship of white womanhood, and assistance that white women might have received in a similar situation. Benedita's labor was the only part of her personhood that was meant to exist in a noble neighborhood. Black women who were living or working in Europeanized neighborhoods and spaces were invisible and improbable protagonists in these spaces. Benedita's journey as a daughter en route to spend time with her mother escapes the bounds of how she was thought to occupy space and interrupts traditional geographies which were meant to neatly confine people or Black women to particular spaces. Benedita's narrative is among one of several dozen depositions by Black women in the early 20th century that illustrates Black people's transit in São Paulo. Her deposition also indicates that she was one of thousands of people to migrate to the city of São Paulo in the early 20th century. Despite slavocratic spatial logic, Black people were not static or fixed to particular geographies. Their transit and navigation across the spaces allotted to them and the spaces they took enable us to rethink how the ideology of political emancipation promised modernization and mobility for some, while it obscured much about the lived experiences of Black women. Benedita's desire and effort to reach her mother in a city that she did not know how to navigate directly addresses Catherine McKittrick's meditation on Sylvia Winter's intervention on the demonic. Winter asks, quote, "What would happen to our understanding and conception of race and humanness if Black women legitimately inhabited our world and made their needs known?" Unquote. The disbelief by Benedita's mother and her mother's patroa that Benedita had come on her own to visit her mother underlies the perceived impossibility of a Black woman legitimately inhabiting the world, having needs, and making their needs known by moving beyond particular geographies. When Benedita set out on her journey to visit her mother, she created a moment and geography to envision possibilities of demonic grounds legitimately inhabiting a place for many Black women in São Paulo in the early 20th century. Catherine McKittrick's Demonic Grounds is, quote, genealogically wrapped up in the historical, spatial unrepresentability of Black femininity and thinks about the ways in which Black women necessarily contribute to a representation of human geography, unquote. Though their race and gender shaped Benedita and her mother's life circumstances and station in life in the afterlife of slavery, methodologies such as Demonic Grounds provides a path to map and see Black women and their contributions in otherwise hostile traditional geographies. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so we still have about half an hour, so we can have our comments from our discussant, and then we can have some questions.
Thank you very much for those presentations. I think they are complementary, and I encourage you to continue to communicate, to work together, to collaborate, because you're exploring a very rich topic, which is severely understudied. And even though slavery ended in Brazil in May of 1888, formally, the question is, did it really end? Did slavery really end in the late 1800s, or did it continue well into the 1900s? To what extent does it exist today in Brazil? And to what extent are Black women in large numbers living, working, and serving in positions that are uncomfortably similar to those of 100 years ago? I raise these questions not only because your presentations were provocative, but I'm from the United States. And when I first went to Brazil in the 1980s, I was in a upper middle class family in Ipanema in the city of Rio de Janeiro. You know, they were friends of friends, contacts, and they invited me over for, I can't remember if it was lunch or dinner, but we sat down at the table, and what did they do? They rang the bell. They rang the bell, and the white and the Black woman came and served the food. And you know, I almost lost it because my grandmother was a servant, was a domestic servant in the United States. So I'm like, what is going on here? What is going on here? And so this is white Brazilian family, but the cook, the driver, the cleaner, we're Black Brazilians. And so I just felt, I'm not liking this scenario. I don't feel comfortable with this imagery, with this situation. And so I liked your presentations because it does center the Black woman. The Black woman needs to be centered because her story hasn't been told in Brazil and in many other countries in the Americas, and obviously around the world. And so I want you to continue what you're doing, deepen your research, and help us get a better understanding of the role of Black people, Black women, Black children, and obviously Black men in the city of Sao Paulo and throughout Brazil. And a question I would raise for both of you is that in your presentations, your written and your verbal presentations, you both seem to lock on to key actors or key characters. And in Kat's presentation, it's Benedita, a domestic servant who searches for her mom and reaches her, visits her on her own. In Cassie's presentation, it is Penteado and the Clube 220. And I like that. And I even wanted more detail. But I also got the impression that both of your presentations hit at a diversity of Black experience in your respective spheres. So Cass, I think you mentioned some other Black clubs in Sao Paulo and other Black leaders, other Black beauty pageants. And so I just wanted more. I just wanted to know, was it very diverse? Or was it, even though they had more than one club, were they very similar? Did they do the same things? Did they have the same structure? Like you said, with that entrepreneurial male leadership, but having a sense of group identity and group mission, including, as is often the case, obviously, women as workers, but also I forgot how you described it, but as the front lines in the struggle for integration. And I really wanted you to elaborate on what you meant by integration. I assume it was racial integration, but I needed more context to understand your emphasis on integration, because were the neighborhoods in, or was the city of Sao Paulo segregated by race, by class? Or, as Kat said, were there overlapping hierarchies, racial, sexual, economic, geographic, that's important, I think, for your argument. And also, being a political scientist, I just wanted some more context and more markers. What's the Black population of Sao Paulo? Where are Black folks located in the city? Kat mentioned that many Black folks and other folks migrated to the city of Sao Paulo. But I don't know what, you two may mention it, but you don't discuss the European immigration to Brazil, which is tremendous and based in Sao Paulo, at least during this period, 1880s to 1920s. What is it? I can't remember the number, 2 million Europeans, Italians, Spanish, Portuguese, Germans, and others go to Sao Paulo, change the demography of the city. Japanese immigration also has a major impact. So I assume you discuss how that impact, those kind of major factors in the story of Sao Paulo impact the Black population and the, you know, in an economic way, in a social way, in a cultural way. And so I wanted a little more information in that regard. Kat, I wanted to ask you if the interviews that you draw on are online and digitized, or did you have to go old school? You had to go old school in the archives. And so that's fascinating. And I guess for my own information, I wanted to know if there were many good books out that you use as kind of anchors to help guide you and that you can refer back to and help orient you. Because I think we are living in a time of tremendous academic and intellectual production by and about Black folks in Brazil. And this is in part a direct result of affirmative action. The success of affirmative action. The universities have more Black students than ever. And those students are going to graduate school. Those students are becoming professors. They're, like you, exploring topics that haven't been previously explored and are demanding their space in the academy, challenging the main themes of Brazilian historiography, geography, sociology, et cetera. And so I'm just very excited at what you're doing. I look forward to reading full chapters and dissertations. And I want to thank you for sharing with us. And I definitely would like us to have some conversation because I have more questions, I have more comments, but I assume other people do too. So I will end there. Thank you again.
So I let you to respond to those initial questions. And then if other people have questions, they can either raise hand or put it in the chat. I have questions as well. So, but I'll let you all respond to Ali's question.
Kat, do you want to go first or do you prefer that I answer first? Okay. Thank you, Dr. Johnson. For your first question, it's very good. This, how is integration being used? And in the context of Brazil and São Paulo in particular, Black associations and Black organizations are using the word integration in terms of Black people being visible, being represented, being seen, in areas of Brazilian culture and society. So at this time, and the census is a very great document for looking at the numbers. In, I think, the 1950 census, there were less than 500 Black people in the liberal professions. Liberal professions meaning doctors, lawyers, dentists, et cetera. Whereas in comparison to white Brazilians or white Brazilians in São Paulo, that number was recorded as more than 10 to 15,000 people. And so they're using integration as like, we do not exist at any level of society except at the bottom. And so if you only exist as a domestic worker, as a page, as a servant, what Kat articulates very well, then you are not seen as a full person in terms of having a voice. And so the work of a lot of these Black organizations is to try to integrate, in their words, the Black man or Black people in general. And they see that through using the arts. So the Teatro Experimental do Negro of Abgias do Nascimento is a great example of that, using theater as a tool to amplify the visibility of Black people, articulating the contributions of Black writers from Machado de Assis to certain abolitionists like José do Patrocínio, and they name a lot of their organizations after these people. And a lot of them are invested in electoral politics as much as it can be viable. So after the post-Vargas moment in the mid-1940s, a lot of Black organizations submit candidates to run. They're not successful, but as you posted, Ejilza Sotero's dissertation really accounts for the dynamics at play. So they're not only trying to create like a Black block for electoral votes, but they're articulating different visions from socialism and communism to a kind of Black liberalism that Panciato encapsulates. Very quickly to your second question, were there diverse actors? Were there diverse organizations? Were they like? Yes. And there were many different organizations in São Paulo. The history of Black associations is very rich. The French e Negra Brasileira is part of this tradition. José Correa Leite manned a lot of these organizations in the 20s into the 50s. So the Associação Cultural do Negro is one of those organizations that he directed. And what is very fascinating is the role of Black women in these organizations. For example, in the 1920s and 30s, including the French e Negra Brasileira, they're very invested in defending Black women, particularly Black women working as domestic servants. They see domestic servants as being the front line of the Black family and the Black community, because at this time, those were one of the few jobs Black women and Black people in general could get, period. But it was overwhelmingly the Black women who are working these jobs. And so Black men at this time are articulating them as being the breadwinners of the family. In the 1940s, however, this championing of Black women kind of falls off in favor for a discourse of integrating Black manhood. So you have the example of the Associação José do Patrocínio that started as a advocacy group for domestic workers, but then becomes transformed through its leadership into a Black arts society. So that is to say that Black women's image is being brought up at different moments and different periods. And in these organizations in the 50s and 60s, they're being encouraged to take a more domestic role. But at the same time, you also have the emergence of Black women's domestic service or domestic labor organizations. So still in the same state, you have women like Laudelina G. Campos Melo, who created the first, what was supposed to be the first union for domestic workers in Brazil, period. They didn't get the recognition until the 70s, but that was a project that she started in the 1930s. And she said that she started it because she was inspired by Vargas, as well as labor movements and the French e Negra Brasileira. So there is a kind of divergence, but she is working parallel to Black associations, even if they're not centering Black women as explicitly as they used to.
I think my situation in terms of demographics in the late 19th, early 20th century is very different. The censuses, there were a couple of years it wasn't taken, and the data is really unreliable. Melissa Nobles talks about this in her work. They also don't report race, so it becomes harder to track people in this particular period. I think one of the things that I try to do in my dissertation is to really show that Black people were here throughout. So there is always this question, what about immigrants? Sure, of course they came, about 3 million, I think, from 1870 to 1930, according to, I cannot think of his name, Emery. He talks about how not all of the immigrants actually stayed here. Jeff Lesser, thank you. And so I just want to show Black people were here, because with the kind of terrible numbers in terms of demographics, one of the things that the elite and the state were trying to do is they were trying to erase Black people. There was the 1920 census. It wasn't really a census because they didn't collect numbers, but they made this claim that by like 2020, all Black people would basically be gone. So their aim was to erase Black people. So the counts aren't accurate. And I, in various chapters, show how Black people's presence and their actions really shaped this city. And of course, you have Bixiga, you have these places where Italians are thought to exist, but you also have places like Barra Funda, or Osei, or Brás that have these really, really rich Black histories that are completely mowed over during the period of immigration, just because they wanted to, São Paulo, Paulistanos wanted to prove their whiteness. I think that recent scholarship has really, really buttressed the work that I've been able to do, just because the numbers aren't there. The documents are really hard to find because they stopped reporting race in the period that I study. I found those interviews through Kim Butler's work. The documents are at USP. I also use, in the other parts of my dissertation, medical reports. It's one of the few places you see race being recorded at all. And so there, I think, are one dissertation, one book, Molly Ball just published a book that actually really talks about workers, immigrants, segregation, labor segregation, that's been really useful in finishing my dissertation, as well as the work that's happening here. There are a couple of Black folks that are mentoring students on Black geographies. I'm thinking of Alex Fratz, and his work on Beatriz Nascimento and Lila Gonzalez. And I kind of use their students' work or people that they work with's work to really try to make sense of just how Black people in the time that I'm looking at understood space. I think that a lot of it ends up being in dissertations, not in published books. So I think that's one of the things that I didn't know before I got here. So it took some digging.
Finish. Yeah. I was going to say, since no one has anything in the chat for a question, I'll go ahead and ask mine. first, I want to congratulate you both on these projects. These are, I'm in the middle of an oral history project on Black Cuban migration and kind of putting together data from oral history. And so I'm excited about these projects that, you know, talk about people's lives that we haven't, you know, written about and haven't necessarily been known. So these are two really important projects. So for Kat, I was wondering, you talked about Black women challenging the whiteness of these spaces, but then they inhabited them as domestics, right? So just their presence didn't necessarily challenge the hierarchy of things. And I'm thinking even today of white neighborhoods, you know, close to where I grew up, where the only Black people you'd see would be those that are pushing, you know, white babies in strollers. But when she visits her mother, she does challenge, right, the hierarchy. And I was surprised even when, you know, the woman told her not to go and she went anyway. Made me nervous for her, actually. But it's really a form of resistance, right? When she visits her mother and navigates the city. And so I'm wondering if you got a sense from the interviews that she felt that she was challenging this hierarchy, or kind of what were some of the women's own positions on race and place and trying to challenge, you know, these things. And then I'll just ask my question for Cassie as well. I was wondering what led you to talk about beauty pageants, because I think it's a really interesting way to kind of look at the kind of work of Black women and the way that they navigated their visibility. And so I was wondering how you came to that. And then if the women involved, you know, went beyond the kinds of activities like the pageants, and what were kind of the boundaries for Black women, or did they create their own boundaries by really focusing on this respectability politics that was involved in, you know, making themselves or kind of curating the perception that they are refined and that they're polished. And sometimes in doing that, right, you can kind of create your own limitations as far as, you know, where you are and what you can do. So those are my two questions. And also we only have 5 minutes. And there's also a question in the chat. So if you wanna answer that as well before we go, and then that will be, I think, it. And the question is for Kat.
So I think I'm gonna try to answer these together as best I can. So I think that one of the things that I'm doing in my project, Catherine McKittrick, is really, like, her demonic ground has really fueled my project. In terms of, what do we call white spaces? If a Black person is there, how can we then call it a white space? So the question of, what does it mean for Black women to legitimately inhabit space and make their needs known? I think when I read this in Benedita's oral history, I was like, she wants to see her mother. She has desires, she has wants and needs. I don't get to see that, particularly in this period. Like, these documents are rich, because most of what you see from Black women at this time come from kind of like what Cassie's doing. So they come from these clubs, but you don't always necessarily hear the women speaking themselves. And so to be able to see that she had this desire and wanted to traverse the city and, like, wanted to actually be here, like, physically in some way and know the city, to me, that's a really gutsy, it's a really gutsy move, because you see in other documents how people had a lot of trouble traversing the city because it was muddy, it wasn't paved. You would take horses or buggies to and from places. So it wasn't a pleasant city even for white people to traverse. And to see a Black woman do that in this way, and again, kind of defiant way of, no, I'm gonna do it anyway, when this woman is kind of like her mistress and her entire livelihood depends on this woman, like the fact that she has a house is dependent on this woman, was significant. And the oral history, I think that this particular person that I look at is pretty self-aware, so it seems. So you can see at various points in the interview, she's kind of monitoring what she says and, like, minding how she answers it. And I think sometimes is a little bit vain, which I really loved. And I think I kind of fell in love with this particular individual. I would say that I became really driven by my own kind of background. My grandmother was a domestic worker and was born in this time. So I'm coming to Brazil looking at the work, the historiography here, and saying, where are people like my grandmother? Why aren't they here? Why can't we see them? And I think that, again, McKittrick has helped me do that, as well as to get at Tiffany's question, I was able to use GIS, not necessarily within the oral histories, but in the medical records, they have exact addresses. And so I was able to kind of map those using, like, an open source system and really show that Black women were all throughout São Paulo. So again, this is supposedly a white city, but I'm finding Black women everywhere. So how can you tell me there's a Black woman here? How can you tell me that this is in fact white? And again, I grew up in a situation too that was, I was surrounded by white people, but I'm like, wait a minute, there's still Black Afro-Latian history where I'm from, and that's also here as well in São Paulo.
Dr. Cleland, thank you for your question. To conclude, I became interested in beauty pageants because I came across a mention in José Jorge Leite's memoir where he's dissing Pinciotto. And he's saying, I can't believe he's wasting precious money that we could be using, you know, to create, to mobilize the people for their rights. And instead it's towards like these frivolous, you know, frivolous beauty pageants. And that made me question, well, there are beauty pageants happening in Rio Grande do Sul, there are beauty pageants happening in Rio de Janeiro. One of them basically uplifted the first Black Brazilian Miss Brazil in the country's history in like 1964, I believe. So I was interested in what are these clubs' investments with beauty pageants, especially because a lot of their discourse around Blackness centers so much on like Black men. I mean, even down to the language, like you say, o negro, and that technically means Black people, but it's technically also the Black man. O negro faz isso, o negro precisa whatever. So I became interested in, well, this could be a unique space to understand how Black men, Black women are being seen by Black men and, you know, what gender discourses exist there. It's hard to navigate what Black women, particularly the contestants, are feeling, but the easiest way to figure it out is how the popular press depicts these contestants versus, you know, a Folha de São Paulo that is more focused on women, the candidates who are of the professional, the liberal professionals. The working class women are being nominated by small local clubs in on the periphery. So where Black people, the majority of Black people are living at this time. So a Casa Verde, like Brasilandia, these places, and these newspapers talk about, you know, what these women want, and they say, you know, I want to be beautiful, I want to be a star, I want to be heard. You can see these similar dynamics with Black women who want to be radio stars in the early 50s, particularly Black working class women. But at the same time, you can even take hints from Carolina Maria de Jesus's like memoirs. To be working class and impoverished typically means that people feel that they can disrespect you and dismiss you. And as it's reflected in the sources, people tend to believe that, oh, this is just social stigma. This is anti-Blackness, misogynoir in action. But in my own dissertation, I'm thinking about these types of conflicts as evidence of defiance, as evidence of, in many cases, labor relations. We don't really think of domestic service as a labor relation, but it is a labor relation between the mistress or the master and the worker. And so for the master or the boss, a Black woman who's who may do something distasteful is just distasteful, as opposed to it could be, I am not going to serve you lunch at this time because you promised to pay me 50,000 cruzeiros. And you said that I talked back to you, so you're only going to pay me 30,000. So I'm not going to do this work. So what would it mean if we actually explored the nuances of these women?
Thank you for that. Well, we're 4 minutes over time, but is there anything else that you to want to add or any other comments that other people have?
Well, let me say, I definitely wanted to continue, but our tech support strongly recommended that we start on time and end on time. And so I look forward to talking to you two later and the other attendees later, but I do recommend that we end now so that we don't jam the next group up, if there is a next group.
But I don't think there is, but we can, you know, people have other, I think, I guess, panels that they might want to attend or, yeah. I think we're the only one on this particular Zoom address for today.
I see.
If I understand it correctly. but yes, so I mean, thank you both for your presentations. As you know, Dr. Johnson said, you know, we would like to continue the conversation. You know, if either of you, you know, want to contact me separately and talk more about this, I'm happy to. I think these are really fascinating projects, and so I congratulate both of you. And thank you for everyone attending, and we'll see you at the next panel. Thank you, everyone.
See you later.